Thank you very much. I'm presenting today of experience about metaplastic breast cancer. Actually, we started a dedicated breast program in our hospital, which is in the Karachi, the biggest city of Pakistan. And we started this program about a year back, and up till now, we managed 150 cases of breast cancer. 14 so far are metaplastic, and if you look at the local data from Pakistan, this is consistent with one of the biggest hospital reported data from Liaquat National Hospital. So what is metaplastic breast cancer? As we know, is a heterogeneous group of malignant breast tumor having different morphological subtypes, and different studies shows that subtypes show different considerable variation in different populations. A paper was published from Braca, and they showed that in Asian population, the subtypes are different as compared to the Western population. If you look at the definition of metaplastic carcinoma, when we labeled it as metaplastic, it varies from author to author. Some authors are taking from less than 10% component, and some authors are taking up to 50%. As we know, it's a rare disease, so incidence is reported in Western literature is between 0.2 to 1%. In Pakistan, the series was published from one of the biggest hospitals, and they published almost 1,100 patients of triple negative breast cancer, out of which 10.7% were metaplastic. As we know, it's generally thought to be a more aggressive disease, having great possibility for a worse outcome. But very little is known about the mechanism which underlie the pathophysiology of this disease. Many of these are tumor triple negative, thought to be locally invasive, large tumor size, less likely to involve the lymph nodes, according to Western literature. The known prognostic variables, which are normally felt to be in breast cancers, may not so be metaplastic. And different papers are quoting different prognostic markers in metaplastic breast cancers. They are saying that probably the metaplastic component or the metastasis of metaplastic components to the lymph node is taken as bad prognostic marker. The pattern of failures in diseases are early. Most of the time, they are treated as breast cancer without regard to the accompanying histology. Best pathological treatment is not known. And last but not the least, the most of the data are largely derived from the case series or population-based studies. I'd like to share here this WHO classification of metaplastic breast cancer that was released in 2003. And they divide the metaplastic carcinoma in two major subtypes. One was epithelial, another is mixed type, having metaplastic component. In epithelial variety, we have squamous adenocarcinoma with the spindle cell differentiation and adenosquamous variety. In mixed type, there's a chondroid metaplasia, there is a variety with osseous metaplasia, and there is carcinosarcoma. So what is the pathophysiology? There are different mechanisms which are studied in different areas. Some are saying there's an epithelial mesenchymal transformation of genes, especially in the sarcomatous varieties. It is thought that phosphatidyl inositol 3 kinase pathway is affected in 53% of cases. They are saying that EGFR is overexpressed, and some of the studies they are showing. And there's a study which showed that stem cell characteristics have seen in metaplastic carcinoma that these cells show positivity for CD44, and they are negative for CD24, like Claudian low breast cancers. This is a paper which was published in Breast Journal of Cancer from Braca, and it is a multi-institutional study. And they basically took data from different institutions. There were three major institutions from England, and four from other parts of the Europe, and three from Asia, including Singapore and Hong Kong. And somehow they reported that mean age seen in Asian population is younger than as compared to the Western population. And Western population somehow show better prognosis than the Asian population. Might be because the Asians have more locally advanced breast cancer than Western population. So what are the reasons for our interest in this study? As we start the breast cancer program, as I already mentioned, it became evident to us as the number began to increase that metaplastic cancers were being seen much more commonly than the published data from Western literature would indicate. We wonder why so much metaplasia is noted in our cases. As we discussed with our colleagues in Karachi, they indicate this is not unusual in daily practice. In our case series, the cases were often squamoid, and they were often periuran inside. So we thought that probably the sexual importance of this organ is normally ignored in most of the studies. So we hypothesized Given the association between squamous cell carcinoma and human papilloma virus, we wonder if there's any linkage in our setting. As we all know that human papilloma virus has been detected in breast cancer, and the Cochrane analysis was published in 2012, and there was a Cochrane analysis of 9 case control studies, and they show that breast cancer is associated with human papilloma virus. But the prevalence of human papilloma virus in metaplastic breast cancer has been reported only in a few studies, and most of them, these are abstracts. So we have 2 areas of interest, that since some oropharyngeal cancers are human papilloma virus induced, and here the presence of P16 is taken as a surrogate marker of infection. Could this be a possible mechanism in metaplastic cancer, especially in the scomoid variety? And the treatment of metaplastic breast cancer most of the time is carried out along the same lines as breast carcinoma generally. So it is acknowledged that best method of treating for this disease is unknown. And most of the individual cities report cases about 20 or so, and they're very small. So why we do P16 in our metaplastic cases? Because it is known that breast cancers may express P16 positivity from 10 to 55%. But there is no data available as far as we, to our knowledge, showing association of P16 positivity in metaplastic carcinoma. But it is taking as a surrogate marker of human papillomavirus infective oral carcinomas. So could there be a relationship between this cancer and human papillomavirus infection? But demonstration for human papillomavirus varies from studies to studies. So we took only the P16. So what is P16? We all know the P16 is a tumor suppressor gene. It activates in response to DNA damage, oncological stresses, and apoptosis. And apart from P50, it is one of the major cell cycle control pathway regulator. And how does it work? Actually, we all know that CDK4 and CDK6 is very important and crucial for many oncogenic transformations. And malignancies are very addicted to the high level of CDK4 activity. So what P16 does? P16 is a tumor suppressor gene, and it actually inhibits the CDK4 and CDK6 activity, which prevents the phosphorylation retinoblastoma gene, so it keeps bound to the E2F state and prevents the progression of cell cycle from G1 to S phase. So if there's a loss of P16 in the tumor cells, there is an uncontrolled cell cycle pathways, and there's a tumor growth. But what happened in human papilloma virus infection? In human papillomavirus infection, there are 2 types of oncoproteins, which is E6 and E7. And we are concerned here with the E7 because it inactivates and degrades the retinoblastoma tumor gene product. And when it's inactivated, E2F become free and it started doing its function, and there's a cell cycle, uncontrolled cell cycle growth from G1 to S phase. But we all know that retinoblastoma is also a negative regulator of P16. So when retinoblastoma got degraded or inactivated, P16 become overexpressed reciprocally. So there is a expression, P16 overexpression in those cases where there's a human papillomavirus infection. I'd like to present my study. This study was conducted in Ziauddin University Hospital, Karachi. And it was conducted after ERC approval. The data was collected prospectively over a year. There were total 14 cases in the study. We did ISC for P16 using the monoclonal antibody, and we scored on a scale of 0 to 3, basically on the basis of nuclear staining and the standard scanning method. This is very important how we diagnose metaplastic and label it as a metaplastic carcinoma. Our pathologist suggests that if they found scomoid component admixed with the mammary carcinoma, they defined as a metaplastic carcinoma with CK5 and 6 positivity. Because of resources constraints and cost constraints, EGFR was not done. As I already mentioned, different authors used different cutoff criteria. In our pathologists use metaplastic component if it's more than 10% as metaplastic carcinoma. You can see it's visible, an HNE, I don't have marker, but you can see in the center, this is scomoid metaplasia with having the scomoid cell with eosinophilic cytoplasm. On the right-hand side, you can see the CK5-6 positivity. On the left-hand side, you can see P16 positivity in the scomoid component. So this is a tabulated form of our cases. this is well established. Most of them are ductal carcinoma, so in our series. Out of 14 cases, 13 were scomoid metaplasia, and only one was matrix producing. All of them were high grade, and we found P16 positivity in 12 out of 14 cases. Only two cases were negative for P16. One of these was having chondroid metaplasia, and one of the scomoid metaplasia. The mean age was pretty younger than the Western reported literature. It was 50.14 years. 12 were ER/PR negative. Only one was HER2 new positive. Triple negative were 11. When we look at the Ki-67 proliferation index, all of them were high grade. And 12 out of 14 were periadular in location. If we looked at the T stage, 7 out of 14 were T2. N stage were normally distributed among N0, N1, N2, and N3. And most of them were stage 2 in our series. Most of the patients received mastectomy. Adjuvant chemo was given to 12 patients. Neoadjuvant was given to 2 patients. And radiation was given to 12 out of 14. So what does the P16 positivity mean? An observation so far, does it have any real meaning? Or it is something more significant? Do human papillomavirus really exist in breast? Or does it alter the response in any way to therapy? As we know that if we look at oropharyngeal carcinoma, if they are P16 positive, they have a very good prognosis. But as far as breast is concerned, the literature is reporting somewhat controversial. Some papers are reporting that P16 positive is a good prognostic marker, and some are taking it as a bad prognostic marker. The other area of interest of our study was the treatment for metaplastic breast cancer. And I have questions. Should the treatment of metaplastic be in a sandwich mode with the usual breast cancer being targeted? Should the second quota of chemotherapy target the metaplastic element if possible? Should concurrent chemotherapy also be an option with radiation? And I hope genomic medicine may come to the rescue. As there are some issues, virtually all publications state that no one really knows how metaplastic should be treated. I have 3 minutes more to go. Most state that metaplastic is a chemo-resistant disease. Because of infrequency, it's treated like a breast cancer. And there are studies which are reporting that chemo-resistance because of the sarcomatoid element or scomoid element. As we all know, taxane does not work with the scomoid carcinomas. So should we go with concurrent chemo and radiation, as we do in oropharyngeal, cervical, and other cancers? This is one of the studies which was done on the metaplastic carcinoma, and they said that radiation really helps in improving the overall survival. This study was published in 2014, and they said that gemcitabine really work in those cases who have low expression of R or M1 gene. And these are the potential drug targets for dietary therapy against metaplastic carcinomas, like PIK3 kinase pathway, MAP kinase pathway, and others. And in the end, I'd really like to acknowledge my team who really helps me in making this study possible and working upon it. Thank you very much for your attention.